Hello everyone. So past 2 days we have a lot of different kind of talks, like related with testing, related with automation and mobile automation and desktop. My talk is almost one of the last talk for this 2 day event, and it is quite similar to automation but little bit different from these all talks. I am not talking about how we can test a particular particular environment or something. I am mostly talking about how I can monitor that application continuously. So the similar way you have a server-side monitoring in place in your organization somewhere. So can you do the similar kind of things using your client side, like as an end user point of view as well? So by taking these points, I am just going with my presentation. My name is Bhupesh. I am a lead software engineer in Adobe Noida. So it's first time for me to be here in Selenium conference. And so I will just begin with the first one. So can anyone of you tell me what is the production monitoring, or even just a monitoring for you for any environment? So when you say a site is down, how can you measure, like, what will be your parameter for that? Okay, so when I'm saying the production monitoring, it is not just related with the front end or back end. It is the monitoring for a whole application together. So that means you are monitoring your application continuously 24/7. Anytime in a UI point of view, anything goes wrong, or from the backend point of view, if your memory consumption goes high, your processor issue is coming, everything should record it, and the alert should trigger at the same time. So on that point, production monitoring requirement. So as I take it further, there are two bullet points. According to me, these are the two bullet points. Why do we need a production monitoring? Like in the startup environment or a new company, we are saying, like, we have 100% coverage in automation, we are doing unit tests, everything is there. But when you go to reality, it is not true in that manner. So when you talk about in that manner, like, you have to release your features daily by daily, and the automation is not that much stable. You have to make sure, like, when you ship your code, after that, it should be up and running as well. So you're, as a tester, developer, or any software professional, your responsibility will not be over just when you deploy the code. Your actual responsibility also started after that as well. So early detection of any production issue is one key factor for any production monitoring. The another point is identifying the non-deployment time surprises. So when I say non-deployment time surprises, maybe your application is quite stable. It has all automation intact. Your monitoring is quite perfect. Everything is perfect. But if you are working in an aggregator environment, or you are the front page of a shopping site, which is actually interacting with n number of different microservices. So you don't have your own database. You are depending on other microservices for it. What happens if any of these microservices is down, and their monitoring is not intact in their side? Ultimately, you will be the your service will hamper. So it's the responsibility in these kind of situations. It should be your responsibility as well to take these measures in these situations. So non-deployment time, it happened maybe someone else is deploying their build, but your build is quite stable. So to mitigate these kind of situations as well, you need to identify these issues in the non-deployment type as well. Then what should be the main criteria for application monitoring for you? One is the server-side monitoring. Can you tell me the another thing, which can be another thing for the monitoring thing? One, I will do server-side monitoring. which I feel most of the companies are doing by using different tools like NewRelic, AppNeta, AppDynamics, these tools all companies are using. But are you doing any other than that server monitoring as well? Yeah, client side. So are you taking, are you using any particular tool for that client side monitoring? But Fiddler can't monitor your application. Fiddler can track the data which is transferring from your network, but it can't continuously poll your application. It can't give you a proper continuous reporting. Okay, so if not, then my talk is for that area only. I'm just representing one tool which I created, for which is responsible to create a continuous polling on your application, and from the front end user point of view, and push that data to one particular server, and you can have a particular dashboard where you can always visualize this data and take a particular action. So just going further, I'll take one example for that. One day, I just opened my Facebook page, and I saw that pop-up. Sorry, something went wrong. Please try again, and after closing that pop-up and reopen it page again. Can anyone also face this particular pop-up in Facebook earlier? If yes, then do you know the reason behind it? We don't need even to know reason behind it, because as an end user, my thing should be, Facebook should be up and running always. I am not their tester or developer. This is Facebook's responsibility to make it up and running always. So then when I just go to the network tab for them, I saw this error. Like there is a 400 in the network tab, and here you can see one of their network tab API is getting failed. Because of that, I'm getting this, this failure. So what I'm trying to tell you, like in the front end UI, there may be any issue, but if you go to the network tab, you will get more further information about these errors and these particular exceptional conditions as well. So we have to test our front end application in the point of these API transfer and the JavaScript binding and the CSS binding in that way as well. So objective of client-side monitoring. So the main objective of this client-side monitoring are identifying the current deployment issues. You are deploying something and you found some issues. So it should be detected in the early stage. Like if I'll take example of a company which is a particular zone based, for example, a company who is operating only in India, their actual end users are using it in the daytime. So, and you're most probably you are deploying your code in the evening time. So if you have a particular mechanism by which you can identify these UI issues earlier at the time of when you when you are deploying your code, you still have the time for a whole night, you can fix it. At least your, and the next day when your end user will come, they will not hamper with that. So the current deployment issues you can identify by this these kind of client side monitoring. Then measuring the page load time. One thing with, for a client side monitoring is very critical thing to measure what how much time a particular DOM page is taking to get load and getting display on the web page. So to measure this particular page load time, if you are doing a whenever you are doing testing and that time, if you are measuring it, it will not be enough. You have to continuously poll your application so that there may be a time to time like load change on your application. Whenever you are testing it, maybe that time your production doesn't have that sufficient load, and you make it as a green sign. Your, for example, your Google page is opening in 1 second, in a 1 second time. But if a whole load comes when it is in the peak load, it took 3 or 4 or 5 seconds, in that time, you you have to measure is it a failed condition for your application or not? Is it breaching the threshold for your particular web page to be getting open or not? Then the third point on which I am focusing with this tool is the uptime of your application in the front end. So out of five, you are running your, I'll take an example of running this tool in a particular web page five times. And out of five, if two times your particular web page is not rendering correctly, it has some network error, these things, so you can calculate the percentage failure and it's the kind of uptime for your web page at the end user point of view. So this is a high level structure and architecture for this tool, how it is created. So you can see two dotted boxes in a below. So the left one is the new structure and the right one the old one. So the old, I'll start with the old one, which is actually using browser map proxy with Selenium. And if you have a particular automation in place, you just have to add browser map proxy with your code setup. And then it is actually traversing your network tab data with your existing Selenium scripts and with different browsers. Then you put that particular data in the form of har. Then this har file is going to the syncap client library, which is just below that that dotted line in the above box. This syncap library is a particular library which I created inside my tool, which you can club with your Selenium code. This syncap library actually pushing this data to the syncap by using syncap REST APIs. So there are some REST APIs exposed to post the data in the database. So this database, then this data is going to the Mongo, and this is the second part. Here you can see this is the syncap user interface. It is a dashboard where you can visualize the real-time data, which is actually representing the load time and the failure conditions or the performance of your particular browser. In the new representation here, which is you can see the bottom left section, here I am not using browser mob proxy. I'm reducing, I'm just eliminating it from the structure. Here I'm just using the performance log, which is I get from the Selenium directly. Then the same library, syncap library, actually parsing this performance log, and this performance log again going through the same cycle to the syncap REST API, to the database, and the real-time dashboard is showing these data. So let's have a quick demo. So it's a plain Selenium script. From here to here, it's the simple Selenium code where the desired capability actually, in the desired capability, I'm opening the performance log for that. And then here I'm creating the web driver instance. Then after that, this is the customized function which I created in the syncap library. This syncap util has two main functions. One is the start tracking, and another is the end tracking. So in between that, whatever you put, like if you are passing a URL or you are clicking on a button, you want a data, hard data or performance data for a particular button click, or you want a performance data for a URL navigation, you just have to put these two functions, start above it, and then the action, and at last, you have to put the end tracking. Nothing else, no wait, nothing. All other, like whatever load it took, what is the timing it took to load that particular web page, what is the error conditions, each and everything will be recorded by this end tracking. So in this end tracking, you will see there are three parameters here. First is the app ID, second is the module, and the third is the coordinator. So app ID means if you have an application, like you in an organization, you have a, you have a number of applications onboarded in your organization, and you want the performance data for each and every application. So the first task will be just give it a particular name to onboard this particular any application which you want to traverse. And like for here, Stack Overflow is an application which I want to measure the performance. So that's why I wrote it in the App ID section. So all the traversing happening inside it will be clubbed with that App ID, and the UI you will see this Stack Overflow as a particular application, and inside it you will get all the data inside. Another the user module. So if I'll go a little bit further, so you can see there are three times I am going, I'm navigating in the URL section, but all time the application is the same one, but the module is changing. So in the first URL navigation, you are actually want to get the data for the user tab. Then another one, you want data from the question section. And the last one, you want data, network data for the job section. So that's why these all are the different module. Third one is the coordinator. This coordinator is actually, it's a name placeholder by which you can identify the workflow, like for what workflow you are actually creating this particular execution. So this particular coordinator will go to the UI dropdown by which you can actually see all the data which is getting captured. So for demo, I'm just running this code. So user, then question. So it is navigating on different panels. And here in the log as well, you can see in the response and request section, whatever data you are capturing through your network tab, I'm just printing it right here to display like these what are the information I'm capturing. So these are the information. You can see the network, like this data, like request will send, network.request will send. So this is the first call when you are actually traversing through a web page. This thing is actually working on the dev tool protocol. So this all format, this JSON is actually on that, following this JSON, this dev tool protocol, Chrome driver JSON protocol. Here, when I, this is the actual dashboard where you visualize this data. So the application was Stack Overflow. Here you can see user test user 2 at the rate gmail.com. So in this particular execution, I made this test user 2 at the rate gmail.com as a coordinator. That's why you are seeing this data here. So when you navigate to it, so this particular panel is the live panel where you can, the script which I run it only for 2 iterations. But ultimately, your goal must be it should run in infinite loop in continuously in a particular CI machine or any other machines. And this, because if you can see here, load time in every 120 seconds. So in every 120 seconds, this page is getting loaded, and it is pulling the data from database, and this particular UI is getting updated. So I can even, if I'll just change the time, so it's now it's started pulling in every 1 second. So I'll just again rechange it so that it will not hamper our flow. Here you can see, so all three URLs. So if I have shown you this, we actually navigate for these three URLs. That's why you are seeing so all three URLs. I mean, right now all three URLs are in the pass condition. That's why in this section you are seeing this image. I clicked here. Now the toggle button changed to show failed zero URLs. There is no failed URL. That's why it's showing zero URLs. Here, the data which captured through the performance log is showing here. This is the URL. I hit it for the two iteration. It took almost average, for two iteration, it took 1.66 seconds. The last execution happened at this time, and there are more detailed link. Here, this is the complete data of your network tab. So here you can see the response code and the files, which are actually you can see in the network tab as well. There are a lot of JS files and XHR file as well. So all the data which is actually transferring from your client to server and the data you are getting from the servers to client are transferring in the form of XHR protocol. It has exposed methods for transferring data from your client to the server. So it is following the same thing. So because when you are monitoring your client application, it can be, the application can be blocked because of any JavaScript binding failure. It can be a CSS failure, load failure. It can be a XHR failure as well. You are posting a data, but because of some server is down or something, it is not posting properly. Or you are not getting proper data because of some server side issue, or your Java binding, JavaScript binding is broken because of the new deployment or something. So all these things you can visualize here. Right now, everything is green. That's why you can you are not seeing any failure. This is otherwise, you, if any one of these status will be failed, you will see these status as a failure as well. Here, this one is showing the last two iteration things. So the first iteration and the next one. So first one took almost 2 seconds, and the second one took almost one second. And this one is the topmost network tab API status for that. So it took like the topmost network tab status was 204 if in this call and earlier one as well. So if it is on a 400 or 500 range, you would see this here, right here. Here in this section, in if you'll click and in any of these blue buttons, here it will draw a graph. Right now, it is iterating only for the two data. That's why the graph is not plotting very smooth. If you run it continuously 24/7, the graph will, the real pattern of graph you can see here. But still, you can see this particular time, it took 2.02 seconds, and load time was that one. And then now, the next iteration was happened with 1.8 seconds. Yes. And then in the bottom, you will see the status code. So the first one has the topmost status code in the range of the 3xx, and the next one has the topmost status code as a 2xx. So these are, and if you'll toggle in between these, so you can see the data is also changing. Okay, then, now, I have recorded one failure condition as well. So I will show you how the failure condition looked like. So I run this tool in the, one day I took, run it in the GM side as well. So gm.com has some broken links. So here, if I'll show you, so if something is broken, you will not see any image which was showing earlier. You will directly see the failure conditions right here. So, and failure condition with the red color. Here, the average time and each and everything are the same. But when you see on that network tab, you can visualize there is a 404 for this particular CSV, CVG file. And for the next one, there is one particular XHR binding was failing. Because in that way, if there you can see there are so all three URLs, but by visualizing here only two are visible. So when you toggle it, you can see all the failures as well. So if you have a n number of different URLs, but only few are failures, by default you will see only these one. If you want to see all others as well, you can go further in that manner as well. So now I have to calculate the uptime of the application. So uptime means, like I said, you are navigating in a particular URL, and because of any binding failure and any XHR failure, your network tab is giving you some error conditions. So on the basis of that, this uptime is getting calculated. So here, by default, the range of this uptime is 399 to 599. You can change it anytime if your organization or your need it in the range of the 499 to 599. In that way, error code status or status code, you can change it anytime. Then the number of days, for how many number of days, because you may need a summarized report for a complete week. So you can change that date for three number of days. So you need a 3 days report, which is actually starting from this 29th, and then ended for each and every date, you need 24-hour data. So right now, I'll just click on that one because, okay. So you can see, I run it like on 29th date range. That's why here you are seeing the count, but there is no count in the 30th date range. So out of these six, five are failure. So that's what the percentage was, 16%. And here, in the home panel, both link are passed, but the failure were in like in that one. Okay, the recent link, one fail and one pass, and other are all failure. So in that way, you can visualize the uptime of your application as well. Now you have a failure. You want to see this, what are these failures as well? So you can directly go to the historical panel from here. It will see, it will search for that particular date range only. And here you can visualize these particular URLs were failed. All have 404 range, and this particular binding was failed on that. So these three components, the live data, and then the historical data, and the uptime is the complete, like right now, the complete package which is in that solution. It still in the not that much completed phase. There are a lot of things which I'm adding on that one as well, but it is in the production ready stage because we already using this tool, but the enhancements are still in progress. So I need these feedbacks as well on that one. So just to summarize on that, like technology part and these things. So when the automation part, I'm using Selenium WebDriver, and for making the older binding intact, I'm using the BMP, browser mob proxy. For the Chrome browser and the new things, I'm using performance log. That's why I'm using plain Selenium code on that one. For the dashboard thing, I am using Java Spring and AngularJS and MongoDB for database management. Then for deployment section, I am using Tomcat to hosting this and Docker to make it containerized. So in that way, it's deployment things happening. Now I'll like right now I created only Java bindings in the client side, but I also exposed REST APIs by which any if you are in any language, you can expose you can put your data on that tool as well. So if you see that curl, so it has an endpoint API/network data. Here in the module section, whatever module you have, you can pass in the D section is actually the body section where you are putting the data in the body section in your curl. And URL, wherever in URL you are navigating, you can put out the URL section. The time it took, you can put it in the total time section. And code message, code status, whatever user is a coordinator who is actually running that flow. So you place that coordinator on that section. So, and you can see in the bottom section, there is a more detailed section. In the more detailed section is the place where you put your network tab data, inside it. So the capability which this tool has, onboarding multiple applications. So like I said, like you can see in the dashboard, there are Stack Overflow, there are n number of different three, four other applications as well. So you want, if you want to onboard more applications on that, you can do this thing as well. So one particular dashboard can summarize each and every application which your organization has. Then other is the 24/7 pull your performance data in the client point of view and put it on the server to visualize it. And the real-time client-side status of your browser. So like I said, soon in the real-time dashboard, it is giving you the real-time dashboard, real-time data. Then if you are searching for the historical event which is failed, you can directly, one way to navigate it through the uptime section, but another is you can directly go to the historical tab as well, and there as well you can get these historical data information. Other is the uptime calculator. Right now it's quite straightforward, whatever the percentage of the pass and fail. I am adding more complex mechanism on it as well. So uptime is for calculating the pass failure conditions for your particular network tab. Graphical representation of the URL's performance. You can visualize these URL load time and these things directly in the screen. Then monitoring application directly, like to like onboard your application on this particular tool, you don't have to change any code change in your actual source code. It is running from outside. So without any code change or without any source code change or any particular installation, you can run it using your existing Selenium code as well. So more thing which I am adding on it are the, right now the alerts, whichever I can create it using the client-side library only. So what I am doing, like I'm moving these things in the dashboard section so that, like, if you use the NewRelic, CloudWatch, these kind of tools, they have a dashboard where you can onboard like these alert situation and these things. So similar thing I'm replicating here as well. Another is add browser site analytics testing as well. So because I am able to capture network type data, that means I have all analytics data as well, whatever transferring from your browser to the server. So to further match it with the baseline data which you supposed to pass as a analytics data, so this tool, I'm enhancing it for this thing as well. And the next one is to support for 24/7 for the desktop application. I'm working with Adobe, so we have a lot of desktop tools as well, where we have to do longevity test for n number of, like, 3-4 days and in that manner. So any time that may be possible because of some performance issue or something, your memory your system memory got a spike on or process got spike or something. So to capture these analytics as well, so I'm enhancing it for the desktop applications as well. So this is all about this tool. Thank you. Any questions? Any feedback? Any questions?
Yeah, hi. It's a wonderful workaround, actually. It's a wonderful workaround.
Thank you.
And I need to understand, say, for example, I'm using one of C-sharp .NET application, which is actually standalone application which is in Windows, and we do have internal URL calls as part of AngularJS sites and all, okay? On top of it will be running on the .NET application, okay? So can we able to capture those kind of URLs all with this?
So my question is, are these URLs visible in your network tab?
Yeah.
So you can capture it.
Okay, so it will be captured in this UI and
correct,
we can able to proceed.
Correct. Because this is using the developer tool protocol, which already Chrome has.
Chrome, sir.
So it is allowing you to get these all, like these statistics out of it.
Okay.
So obviously you can capture these data from.
Okay. And one more thing is, like, say for example, if you want in browser side, if you are running this in a grid kind of thing, then how this report section will be manipulated?
So you are talking about that when you are running in a grid or something.
Yeah.
So I coded it in the Java only right now. So I can show you, and it's not a grid code right now. But still, whatever driver I instantiated, I made it as a thread local, which is a thread safe kind of thing. So in that way as well, you can do, if you, it is your question, in the threading point of view or something. Otherwise, whatever you, like your each and every session through grid as well is individual session. So whatever, when you're traversing your application as an individual, so individual call will go to this particular dashboard only. So it will handle that isolation, because these isolations are actually happening in your client-side code. Dashboard is not doing any isolation. Your code side, if you are able to run grid execution parallelly, successfully, then you can push the data here as well. You are talking about the browser level or something?
So what he meant is
okay,
the metrics aggregation.
Yeah, good. So actually, these kind of feedbacks I also need. But right now, what I can told you what we can do, in place of putting just, because this user is the same, but we are sending directly from as a coordinator. So if I, in place of directly user, I Chrome/ this one, I can differentiate different data set in my execution cycle. It will visualize in different manner here. So suppose this thing is not directly user test user data. It is Chrome:test user data. You can directly go to this URL. It is giving you the data for Chrome driver only. If it is done by the Firefox, it will give you the Firefox data only. So you can isolate it in that manner. And I'm also, whatever you are telling, I'm checking for that enhancement part as well on that.
Any more questions?
Hi. So how is it different from web page test?
Web page?
Web page test.
Web page test.
Yeah.
So web page test is continuously polling your application, is it? Is it, can you host it? I haven't used it. So can you host it in your premises?
It has a similar thing, and what is the difference?
So if you have a staging environment, which is a pre-prod, can we do the same kind of testing in the, these kind of tools as well? Is it possible?
If my testing, if my test environment or staging environment is accessible outside the network, then yes, we can do it. If not,
if it is not visible, for example, I'll take the example of Adobe only. Our staging environment is that much critical as our production environment. We can't, it is not exposed to each and everyone outside, but it's that much critical for us. So in that much, at this kind of scenario, we have to make it up and running always. So if I have to run these kind of tools in these environments, can it be possible?
I guess web page test also have an option to host the web page test on a particular server.
Okay, maybe.
On your site. So just wanted to know the difference between those.
So,
and
yeah.
You have replicated that only with some reporting differences, but otherwise it's looking
so main
same to me.
So the main purpose is to use the existing, you don't have to migrate your existing Selenium code. The same Selenium code you can use with this framework, because, and the dashboard is separate part. It is not, you talk about the particular tool, it is specific for the web. So what I am targeting, I am adding other features on that tool. Like for example, I told regarding the analytics things, I am adding for the desktop performance. So this is actual goal. Maybe this thing is possible with your tool, whatever you told. But the main purpose for this tool for me is that one, to add different other things as well.
And it also has the options to verify your application in different continents, I mean, in different geographies.
Different environment?
Different geographies. If you want to test how your product environment behaves in, suppose, US or Germany or something like that. So you can specify.
So correct.
That.
So different locations or something, is it? So this code is actually a code which is a client-side automation script. So what you can do, you may have a different EC2 instances in dedicated to different zones on like in a Java, because it's ultimately it's a, like not a paid tool or something like NewRelic or kind of thing where you pay money and they will host a particular solution. It's a solution which you can host in the in-premises kind of thing. So yeah, but that thing you are telling, it is possible.
Hey, it was a good demo. How can I pull, like how are you pulling the network data from browser to the dashboard? So it is directly communicating to the MongoDB? How are you dumping the database?
So I will just again go to. Again, it will come from start. So if you see that slide here, these browsers are running using Selenium. And then performance data, actually this performance log is getting all the data from these browsers and Selenium using the this performance log. Then I'm actually, it has a lot of raw data as well. So I'm parsing this performance data using the syncup library, which is actually client-side library. I have shown you two methods. So these two methods are inside this library only. So only there are no other methods. There are two methods which are sufficient to do this mechanism. Then this the upper section is actually dashboard section. This is putting the data on the with the help of that curl which I shown you to the MongoDB. And then there is a separate part dashboard which is actually polling continuously and you are visualizing.
Hello. So how are you calculating the response time in a single page application?
Yeah. So there are two parts. One is the browser mob proxy and another is the performance log. Browser mob proxy, it is quite easy because it creates a HAR which already has these like data which you have to like the performance load time and you just have to sum it and you can print it. But in case of this performance log, it has some events like and the timing time format which this dev tool protocol used, it is not using the timestamp. It used a particular system date format. So you in the first method which I shown you as a start method, I'll go to code again, this one. This method is actually doing nothing but just inside it here. It's calling this system.nanotime, a particular date format, time format, and it is storing it. And the actual work is happening inside this end tracking tool. So this end tracking tool is actually getting all the data from the network tab, and then there are a lot of page load time events are happening inside it. So I'm getting the page load event time from this network tab data, and then checking that how much time it took from the start till that page load event load time.
But since it's a single page application, we are mostly having the AJAX calls, right?
Sorry?
Since it's a single page application, we are mostly having the AJAX calls, right? So how are you identifying if all the AJAX calls are finished?
And so when you say single page application, this project I made for a single page application only, which is actually Angular based application. So it is running for, I created it almost 2 years before. In between that, I migrated, when I moved to Adobe, I then 1.5 years I moved to backend services. So it is not, after that, I again restarted that project few months before. So that's why I'm telling, like from past 2 years, this tool is running for a single page application only. So there is no issue with the single page application number.
Okay, so will it introduce any kind of slowness actually? Because we are having a plugin which takes the performance data and all, right? So will it induce any slowness? And the performance data that you have captured, it can be more, right?
So slowness because of these tool bindings and these things, is it?
Yep.
So when I use browser map proxy, because of proxy, it can happen, like slowness can, it can introduce, because now the data is passing through a particular proxy. When, but now the new implementation where I am just using Selenium's implementation, so whatever slowness Selenium can create in my code, that's only the slowness on that.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. I think we'll wrap up, and Bhupesh will be all here helping with us. Can we give...
If anyone has any question, and even a feedback as well, I'm here. You can give me your feedbacks and any questions. I'm ready. I'm good.
Yeah, Bhupesh, one last question. So do we have this tool open source and we can start
using?
So
before coming here, I was planning to do it as a Git repo. But what happened, I got some feedback for enhancement and these things. Because of that, I just delayed it for one at least few months so that I can incorporate these feedbacks as well. And now here as well, I will see a lot of feedbacks. I will incorporate
all right.
And
all right.
Then make it.
All right. Yeah. Thank you. Can we give him a big round of applause for creating such awesome tool? And which also means that you open source it and we use it.
Definitely.
In some months. Thank you.
So before
Thank
releasing you. The video, I'll plan to release that tool.
Thank you.